Mark 16, verse 7. But go your way, tell his disciples and Peter. I want you to notice that phrase right there. But go your way and tell his disciples and Peter. Peter got singled out right there in that phrase. Tell all the others, but make sure you tell Peter also that he goeth before you into Galilee, and there you shall see him as he said to you. Everything he said is going to happen. It's going to happen just like he said. Make sure you tell Peter that. I want to preach a little while tonight from the subject of it ain't over. Somebody say it ain't over.
It ain't over.
Say it like they say, it ain't over.
It ain't over.
All right, Psalms 22, beginning at verse 9. This is David. This is a messianic psalm. It's a prophecy of Jesus. And much of what you read in Psalms 22 happened on the cross to Jesus. And I don't have time to exegete all that for you tonight. But many times when David was writing the Psalms, not only was he writing about his life or his feeling, but it was also a prophecy of what was going to happen with Jesus. Many of the things David said in his Psalms, Jesus said on the cross. Many times David would get so caught up in the spirit. See, that's the power of worship. It can begin to show you the future. That's why the enemy hates your worship and hates your praise. That's why he tries to bombard you right where you are, because then you don't get a forecast of where you're going. If you get so caught up in where you are, you refuse to see where you're going. And if you don't see where you're going, you ain't never going to get there. The Bible says, without a vision, the people perish. David was so good at getting in the presence of God. Not only would he see where God was going to take him, despite his struggles and his circumstances and his weakness, but there was such a spirit of worship on David that he would get so caught up in the things of God that God would give him a forecast, not just of what he was going to do in his life, but what he was going to do in Jesus' life. David got a glimpse of the new covenant while he was still in the old covenant. And in Psalms 22, he's talking about him, but he also begins to shift gears and begins to prophesy about Jesus. And I'm captivated by these verses that I'm getting ready to read you. But thou art he that took me out of the womb. Thou didst make me hope when I was upon my mother's breast. I was cast upon thee from the womb. Thou art my God from my mother's belly. Be not far from me. For trouble is near, for there is none to help. Have you ever felt that way? Many bulls have compassed me. Strong bulls of Bashan have beset me round. They gaped upon me with their mouths as a raven and roaring lion. I want to preach a little while about that, because David here begins to, not only is he talking about Jesus, but David gives a glimpse of how he saw God. And if you can find out, have you ever seen somebody that wins at life and you think, I would love to think like they think. I would love to have the mentality that they have. I know me and Taylor have talked many times about Rich Froning and CrossFit competitors. And it seems like everybody that reaches a certain level in anything, they think different than the average person. It seems like anybody that ever gets to the next level in life, it seems like there's a way they think that's uncommon to the normal and uncommon to the natural. That's why leaders love to get around other leaders that are going somewhere, because they find out they don't think like everybody else. If you're ever going to get to where God called you to get to, you've got to quit thinking like everybody else. You see, it don't matter if you get a new car, it's still going to be you that's in it. If you get a new house, if me and Carlene bought a new house, we got a new house, it would still be us living in it. A new house doesn't give you a new marriage. A new car doesn't give you a new marriage. Some people think, if I could just go to a new town, well, that'd be great. The only problem is, if you go to a new town, you're taking you with you. Nothing changes out here until something changes in here. I've seen people have it good out here, but we're so messed up in here, they sabotaged every good thing in their lives. Say amen, somebody. But I've seen other people that had challenges and circumstances, but they had such victory in here, they had peace and they had joy. I'm going to preach it here in a little bit. But most of the time, my man Greg sits right here in a wheelchair. Sits in a wheelchair from the time he was born. He's never walked. But you know what? I've never seen Greg frown. I've never seen him cuss somebody out. I've never seen him hang his head and say, I can't take it. Because Greg's got victory in here. Ah, you need to give God a praise right now. Because if you get it in here, this is the message hell doesn't want you to hear. Because life has tricked us. And life has lied to us. Told us we get the new house, we'd be happy. Get the new house, get a big payment, more miserable than ever. I can get the new car, I'll be happy. Get the new car, you find out it gets flat tires just like the old car. If I can get the new wife, ain't gonna say it. But you find out nothing changes until you change. That's why I win or lose everything in life in my head. The problem with the church is when we see somebody fall out there, we say, oh, that's when they fail. No, they fell up here long before you ever saw it out there. You might see them give up and quit, but I submit to you that something went wrong up here probably 6 months before you ever saw it. I found out that people can be hurting in here and you don't know it. That's why we have to be sensitive to the Holy Ghost, because people can fake you out. People can come into this church and look like they got it all together, and they've got the perfect wife, and they've got the perfect kids, and still going through hell in here. They've got the husband they prayed for. They've got a job others would kill for, and still crying themselves to sleep at night, because it ain't so much about what's going on out there. The warfare is always in here. The biggest battle you ever fight, let me help somebody. If you don't get nothing else out of this message, you get this. The biggest battle you'll ever fight will always be between your ears. I have seen people, if they win the battle between their ears, they win in life. But I've seen people that were gifted, appointed, and anointed, and they begin to lose it up here, and everything around them begin to crumble. But I have seen other people whose lives were in shambles, had needle marks in their arm, had a record a mile long, but they let God get a hold of their mind, and he began to lift them up out of miry clay. I serve a God that said, I'll give you beauty for ashes. That inherited millions of dollars and they're miserable. I know other people that inherited debt and dysfunction and they're happy. All because of the difference of what's going on between their. If you get around somebody that's winning, you find out they think different than the average man. And all of life tries to make you think just like everybody else. If you think like everybody else, you're going to get what everybody else got. That's why God tries to give you uncommon thoughts. That's why God tries to move in the realm of your mind. And that's why the God of this world, that's why the world is set up to beat you into a mold to where you're just like everybody else. I'm going to let you off the hook. God didn't put you on this planet to be like everybody else. God put you on this planet to be you. God gave us Clifford so Clifford would be Clifford. Ah, come on, somebody. God gave us Summer to be Summer. We don't need none of TD Jakes, but I'm the best Barry Ebser you ever gonna hear preach. Imitation is suicide. So afraid to be who we really are. But every man of God, I found a secret to their thinking. I'm gonna let you in on it. I found a secret to Jeremiah, to Isaiah, to David, to Apostle Paul, to the characters in the Bible that seem to rise up out of mediocre Georgia. They seem to rise up out of the ordinary. And the secret was they knew God was involved with them before they ever got here. Can I just beat up some religious teaching right now? Because if you listen to most preaching, and you listen to most preachers in certain areas, they would make you believe that God didn't have nothing to do with you until you got saved. You just lost and undone, and you were. But my Bible tells me no man can come except the Spirit of God draw him. The Bible I read teaches a God that doesn't meet you at the altar. He met you before you got your mama's womb. My Bible teaches me a God that said, I'm going to make you fearful and wonderful in your mother's womb. My Bible teaches me that my eye color, it came from God. My hair, it came from God. Dr. Phil are making millions because people feel bad. And if you talk to a lot of people, you find out one of the culprits of them feeling bad has been the misuse of this book that was sent to make them feel better. Jesus said, not Mary Absher, but Jesus. Jesus said, these words that I speak unto you, they are spirit and life. But I have seen many people misuse this book and beat the faith out of people and beat the hope out of people. Jesus said, the Bible said, without faith, it is impossible to please him. He didn't say it's your hairstyle. He didn't say it's the length of your shirt sleeve. I'm going to see how many people are going to make mad. He didn't say it's what denomination you're joined to. He said, faith is what pleases me. In fact, before Jesus left, he looked at his disciples and he said, when the Son of Man returns, will he find faith? He didn't say, will I find a big building beside the golf course? He didn't say, will I find a big denomination? He said, will I be able to come back to this earth and find somebody that still believes I'm able to do what I said I could do? If you've got any faith in him, I need you to take about 10 seconds and let God know there's some faith in this room. Faith to believe God to touch your family. Looking for faith. He found faith in the harlot Rahab and he brought her out. He found faith in the man named Noah, brought him out. He found faith in Samson and he restored him. None of the characters in the Bible were perfect, but the ones that were used had faith. The Bible said every man is given the measure of faith. I'm throwing some stuff out here. I found out when I ain't got nothing, that's when God really pours stuff out. Every man, every woman, every boy, every girl, God put no person on this planet without faith. Said unto every man is given the measure of faith. You have faith in you. You choose to activate it or you choose to deactivate it. The atheist has faith. He just uses it the wrong way. God would not put you on the planet and not give you the ability to believe him. My problem ain't my faith. My problem is the knowledge of the object of my faith. Can I preach this a little while? What's the Bible say? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word of God. Amen. My faith comes by hearing. If I hear the word of God, my faith in God is going to be built, and it's going to go forward. Am I right about it? But if faith comes by hearing, and I'm hearing the wrong stuff, something else, I'm going to get faith that it's going to go bad. Y'all going to catch me in a minute. You put Carlene in an atmosphere where the word of God is being preached. She comes out. One time we were, can I tell the story? We don't know. She said, I don't know. Let the Holy Ghost touch you, baby. Let it touch you. We were broke. And there was this preacher on TV. And, you know, sometimes preachers on TV get a little, you know, we've all seen it. But this was good. This was good. I was in the other room, you know, and we were newly married. Carlene, that's how she is all the time. She's calm. She don't get excited. If Carlene ever runs around this church, you will know it's the Holy Ghost, or I finally gave her a nervous breakdown. One of two things. So I thought, when I heard her up on the couch, jumping up and down, said, I'll never be broke another day in my life. We're in a double wide. We got a hole in the roof, and I heard her screaming. And I came out of the bathroom, I thought, well, she snapped. She snapped. And she's looking at that TV and shaking her fist going, I'll never be broke another day in my life. I thought, oh God, what's happening? I look at the preacher saying, I'll never be broke another day in my life. And I look at Carly, she's going, I'll never be broke another day in my life. I jump on the couch with her and I go, we'll never be broke another day in our life. Because she was responding to something that built her faith. And that was over 15 years ago. Can I tell you something? We might have been bent, but we ain't never been broke. We've been badly bent, but we ain't never been broke another day in our life. I wish I had a video of me and her on that couch. No, I don't. But sometimes when the word's released, you're going to get excited about it. There's something on that moment, because it was so tough at that time, that it released some good in us. It released some faith in us. But did you know at other crucial times in your life that the wrong word is spoken at the wrong time? Have you ever noticed how you can be in a good mood and somebody say something and it don't really mess with you? I mean, you notice it, but you kind of shake it off. But have you ever been wounded? And then stuff that didn't used to bother you starts sticking. I talked to a young man the other day, and he's going through a wounded season. This same young man used to be able to laugh at everything. He would laugh at anything that come his way, but he had some words come against him. He had some people come against him. He had some people quit believing in him, but people that started making him doubt himself. And I watched all this happen on the outside looking in. Can I preach this? Because I think God's talking to somebody. I watched him over a period of time. Because what I found out about life is it don't just happen overnight. A lot of times it's over a period of time. He got a job around some people that started making him doubt himself. He got around some other people that started making him doubt himself. Doubt his faith, doubt his purpose, doubt his intelligence, doubt his intellect. He got around some other people that were related to him that started doubting him and making him doubt himself. And this guy never used to get his feelings hurt. He was the loudest guy in the room. He was the life of the party. He was able to shake off anything and hug everybody. And I noticed, he started walking like this. And he called me the other day and he said, preacher, he said, somebody came by me the other day and they said a little something to me. And as soon as he told me, I knew that that person didn't mean nothing by what they said. And the Spirit of God rose up in me and I said, the only reason that hurt you is because you're wounded. I said, that person didn't mean nothing by what they said. But when you get wounded, you get vulnerable to stuff that you ain't vulnerable to when everything's going all right. Am I right about it? The Bible said the spirit of a man will sustain his infirmity, but a wounded spirit who can bear. So when Andy is good, the Bible said there's a spirit in Andy that even though he's going to have weaknesses and have struggles, his spirit's going to make sure he's okay. But the Bible says if that spirit gets wounded, that's when he becomes vulnerable. And I have seen people let the words of people, the same words that can build your faith, negative words can break your faith. And if you put your ear in the hands of whoever has your ear has your future. If you give your ear to people of faith and people preaching the word of God, they're going to pull you into your future. But if you give your ear to a bunch of gossipers, bicker and backbite and believe nothing people, they will pull you down the wrong road. I just come to tell somebody there ain't nothing wrong with a delete button. There ain't nothing wrong with an unfriend button. There ain't nothing wrong with a quit following them button. Anything that's dragging you, show me your friends. I'll show you your future. Show me who's speaking to your life right now. And I can give you an indication if you don't change that of where you're going to be 5 years from now. Because that's why the Bible talked about the companion of fools. That's why the Bible said don't be unequally yoked. Don't get around people that are constantly breaking your spirit and breaking you down. Everybody that God used in this book, they realized God was with them in their mother's womb. He put everything in them they would need for their assignment. Everything in them they would need. He made them the way he wanted to make them. He fit them and fashioned them in a way that they could do what God had called them to do. Because God would not put you on this planet with an assignment and not give you the ability to fulfill what he had called you to do. What I'm just trying to tell somebody is if God's will leads you to it, his grace will always get you through it. God will never put you in a battle that you can't win. So if you're in a battle, you ought to praise God because the fight's done been fixed. God's done said that when this thing's over, my child's coming out on top. Somebody ought to praise him for that, right? That's somebody's word tonight. That's your word tonight. I have two kids, and I would never put them in a fight they couldn't win. Well, I'd never put them in a fight. Well, yeah, I would. I'd let Jake box. But I would never put them in a situation that I felt like they couldn't win. Me and Carlene were talking about this on the way to church today, on the way to church tonight. She said, we were talking about how some people view God, that if you don't make the right confession all the time, like cancer is just going to jump on you, or you're just going to have a car wreck. You know, have you ever met people like that, that they're afraid to say anything, afraid, you know, they'll say the wrong thing, and it's almost like they become robots? And she said, Barry, she said, this is what God uses with me. She goes, I can go from wanting to choke Grace. See, Grace is not here tonight, so I'm going to throw her under the bus. She said, I can go from wanting to choke Grace, because Grayson knows how to work on my. She said, and then I'll be looking through a magazine that's supposed to look pretty on it. And I can go right from wanting to choke her and say, I need to order that for Grace. Grayson will look pretty in that. Because as a parent, you always put their best interest even above their behavior. Jesus taught that. He said, if you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Spirit to them that love Him? And I know you want to act like you deserve every blessing God ever gave you. But the truth of the matter is you ain't deserved half of the stuff God gave to you. It came by His grace. So why don't you give Him some praise for it right now? I thank God He didn't give me what I deserve. I thank God He didn't reward me according to my works. But He rewarded me according to the blood of Jesus. David prophesied this, but he also spoke of himself. He said, you put hope in me while I was on my mother's breast. While my mother held me, he said, you put something in me that hoped in you. I never could explain it, but there was always something in me that knew God was real. One time we were playing basketball, me and Pastor Bobby were playing basketball with one of our friends, and he messed up, we beat him at the ball game, and he looked up in the heavens and he started cussing God. Now, I was rotten, Joel, but I knew you didn't do that. Me and Bobby was a full-blooded heathen. Y'all pray for me. He looked up, Rick, into the heavens, and this guy shook his fist at God. And I said, do not do that. I said, don't do that. I said, he'll get you. Because that's back, you know, I was raised up, God will go get you. And I just knew God was going to split him wide open right there. I was waiting for the lightning bolt to just cut it down in the middle. And he said, oh, you think your God's going to do something? And he starts cursing God. Me and Bobby hide under the car because I was convinced. I was like, he's going to light you up like a Christmas tree, man. I was done doing that. I was like, he is going to hit you with a bolt of lightning, and you're going to just, ain't going to be nothing left but your tennis shoes. And you know what? That guy's still alive today. If I'd have been God, I'd have lit him up. I'd at least chopped off a leg or something. But God's a good, good Father. I want you to give God a praise. That even when we were without strength, in due time Christ died for the ungodly. For scarcely for a righteous man would one die. Yet peradventure for a good man some would even dare die. But God commended His love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for the ungodly. Much more than being now justified by His blood shall we be saved from wrath through Him. I need you to give God a praise if you know. There's power, power, wonder-working power in the blood. God's good to the sinner. God's good to the atheist. God's good to the heathen. But He's a whole lot better to you.
Amen.
God's good to everybody. He's a good, good Father. If God was like what we thought He was, half the planet would have done been wiped off the map. But the Bible says He's patient, long-suffering. And God realizes that all you need to go forward is to hear a word at the right moment. Because I found out when I'm wounded and vulnerable, I can be vulnerable to the words of the enemy, but I also become very sensitive to the word of God. And there have been many times I've come to the house of God wounded. I could have went to the bar. I didn't. I could have went to the wrong place. I didn't. I bring my wounded hind end to church. I tell you, when you're wounded, get to church. When you don't feel like coming, that's when you really need to be here. When all hell's coming against you, it ain't time to stay home and pull the covers up on you. You're in the right place for God to put a word in you that'll turn everything around. Desperate people will soak up a word from God. I've tried to preach a word from God to people that weren't nothing. You know, everything's good and that's cool. They had just enough Jesus to get them through. And they hardly preached it. But I preached in prisons where they had 20-year sentences. Preached in prisons where there was gang violence going on in there and you had different groups sitting together and you could feel the tension. But when the Spirit of God began to move, you could feel all those wounded men. The Spirit of God just began to pull on them, began to touch them. When I'm wounded, I'm either fertile ground for the Spirit of God or fertile ground for the enemy to plant the wrong thing in me. Here's how we miss God many times. When you pray for an oak tree and God gives you an acorn. You say, God, you didn't answer me. I prayed for an oak tree. You gave me an acorn. But wisdom knows that the oak tree is in the acorn. God operates in seed. And if you will take the seed God gives you, it'll grow into the thing that you're praying for. You're saying, God, I want to be free. I want to have friends. I want to do stuff for people. I want to help people. And God says, to have friends, you must show yourself friendly, which means
means you're never going to be popular as long as you look like Grouchy Smurf. Why don't you go out of your way and be nice to somebody and sow that seed, and you'll be amazed at what grows out of it.
The church misses the harvest because we don't realize God deals in seed. You pray, God, send me people. Send me people. Send me people that will change Tazewell County. Send me people that will move. People that will influence and change. And the reason a lot of preachers never get harvest is they don't recognize it when it comes. Because it's not going to come rolled up in here in a three-piece suit with a $20 million bank account. When God sends you something, a lot of times it's going to come fresh out of jail, busted marriage, tormented mind, or a 19-year-old nervous wreck like I was. But the thing was that helped me is when I came into the church, there were people sensitive to the Holy Ghost that they saw the seed in me. They saw that I wasn't the finished product, but there was something in me. If they would cultivate, God could use it. That's why Paul said, know ye no man after the flesh. God says, if you're ever going to be the church I've called you to be, you've got to quit worrying about how many times they've been married, how many times they've been locked up, and how many people don't like them. Quit looking at the outside and begin to see what I put in them. And if you begin to see what I put in them and speak to the seed, the man and woman of God will grow. Somebody give him praise for that one. But it takes time. You say, what's this got to do with Simon Peter? Everything. Because Jesus picked him. You wouldn't have. You'd have never picked on Simon Peter. No, sir. Cussing. I seem like on the bank with a big chew of red man. It's my story. I won't tell how I want it. He's fishing. He's cussing. He's uneducated. He's dirty. And if you were Jesus, you said, we're going to leave that alone. But Jesus looked into him, and he said, I see the seed, what my Father put there. And Jesus took on Simon Peter, and he began to pull into him. And Simon was the most obnoxious of the 12. He was. Simon was the most spunky of the 12. God likes spunky people. Simon was the one that he'd jerk out a sword and chop your ear off. Simon was the one that had to clean his feet because he was always sticking them in his mouth. Have you ever met people like that? Simon was the one that would have got on your nerves. But yet Jesus said, Simon, I want you to hang right with me. Out of the 12 disciples, it was Peter, James, and John that got to be the closest to Jesus. There was something in Simon Peter that Jesus loved. And part of it is revealed in his name, Simon Peter. Simon Peter. Simon. Peter. Simon means shaky, weak, fragile, blown to and fro. But Peter is Petros, rock. So shaky on one side, but a rock on the other. Shaky, but solid. Both of them in the same man. And before you act all confused, look at you. Look at me. Because a lot of us, we got those solid rock areas that if God just anoints and touches, man, we're going to tear up the world. But we all got those shaky issues, those doubts, those fears, those relationships, those insecurities. And it seemed like this man was caught somewhere between being the shakiest disciple there was and the rock that God was going to do something with. And there were times you look at him and he was shaking. But there were times you looked at him and he was Petros, the rock, unmovable. When they were all on the boat and Jesus began to walk on the water, it was he that stood up and said, I want to walk on water with you. And while the other 11 said, we're going to stay dry in the boat, he said, I'm going to walk on water with Jesus. And we give him a hard time because he sank. But the fact of the matter is he's the only one that had enough grit to get out in the first place. You ought to give God a praise every day because the people you've seen fail, the only reason they fail is they went further than you did. Simon Peter, there was other times though, he would just blow your mind, he'd say something dumb. Like, Lord, why don't you call fire down on them? And I see Jesus just going. There were other times Peter would say, Jesus, I got you. If anybody loved him, Simon Peter loved him. Don't think that the only people that love God are perfect people, because if that's the case, nobody loves him. Amen. Simon Peter loved him. He loved him. Yes, he had shaky areas. Yes, he had issues he was working through. Yes, he had some rough edges. But there was something in him that said, I love Jesus. He reminds me of you. He reminds me. Every one of us in here, if you come to church on a Wednesday night, you can't tell me that part of you that loves Jesus. Amen. You can't tell me there ain't something in you that looks up in the heavens and says, I need you just as much today as I did when I first got saved. There's something in a Wednesday night crowd that, yeah, you might be shaky, and yeah, if everybody knew everything about you, they might judge you, but they're home watching that, and you're here giving God a praise. I want you to give God some praise right now. Disciple that had credentials that were worth repeating was Judas. And we see how that turned out. The other 11 were misfits, mismatched. The reason he had the occupation as a fisherman is because he was deemed too uneducated and too unintelligent to ever be a scribe, ever be a scholar, or ever be a priest. Because in the Judaic tradition, what they would do is they would take the boys by 12 and they would decide who was smart enough to be a priest, who was smart enough to be in the temple. So they had obviously said, this boy, Simon Peter, ain't never going to get it. And they kicked him to the curb and said, he ain't got it. Can I tell you that when me and John got moved for us and we got kicked out of Christian school, thank you, Jesus. We got kicked out of Christian school. They put me in remedial English. My mom, they took me to learn how to read. I had to get tutored in the summertime. And, you know, they thought I had learning this. I probably do. But if you would have went by what teachers thought about me in that transitionary phase, and then when I would have to stand up in class and speak to people, Georgia, my knees would shake so bad. So bad it was embarrassing. And I would lose my breath. I'd hyperventilate. You know, so the only way I could get by was just act rotten, act crazy. You know, I was in remedial English classes. I was in all these things that just said, you know, you ain't going nowhere, blah, 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 blah. And something about that got in me. And I started thinking, you know what, I'm dumb. I'm stupid. I'm this, I'm that, I'm the other. But something happened at age 19. I came in contact with the God that I'd known as a 10-year-old boy. And he just totally invaded my life, and he began to remind me of what I wanted to do when I was 5 years old. When I was 5 years old, I told everybody I'd be a preacher. And I began to study the Word of God. Now listen, I was somebody that said didn't have good reading comprehension. Somebody that said, you know, just couldn't do literature, couldn't do none of that. I began to study the Word of God, not to be smart, but to keep from going crazy. I studied the Word of God because that's the only way I could sleep good at night. I studied the Word of God because it reminded me God loved me and he had a purpose for me. The Word of God wasn't an option for me. It was a necessity. But as I began to study the Word of God, he began to open up the Word of God to me. Carlene said, you got to go back to college. I went back to college after we got married, worked a full-time job, preached every night, and got my degree because I found out greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. And when God gets a hold of you, it breaks off every limitation they tried to put on you. I'm preaching to somebody right now. It's a lie what they told you. It's a lie what they said about you. And hell's nervous that you're going to listen to these words. Because I let the words of teachers, I let the words of hateful adults tell me how far I could go. I wonder how many people I'm preaching to right now that you've let the words of people tell you how happy you can be, how far you can go, what you can accomplish. And some of the people that spoke those words over you, they ain't even alive no more, y'all. But you're still letting their words limit how far you go. David, Peter, Paul, Jeremiah, Isaiah, they had this in common. They all let God's word trump the word of man. You decide every day of your life whose word you're going to live by. Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the word. It's not just the word you hear, but it's the person that said it. I choose to believe the words that God Almighty has spoken over me. And when I do that, it cancels out every negative word that's been spoken. I heard a guy say one time, he said, you know, we've all heard it. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but words will never hurt me. I got a new one. Sticks and stones have broken my bones, but words have about killed me. And everybody I counsel in that office, you know what I find out the biggest thing they're fighting? Words. Words that somebody spoke over. Maybe it was a parent. Maybe it was a spouse. Maybe it was somebody when they were vulnerable just spoke the right word at the right time to crush everything on the inside. And hell gets nervous when you come to church, because hell realizes that there's a power in the word of God that uproots the negative words that have been spoken over you. And you begin to dare, and you begin to dream, and you begin to believe. And I'm going to say it because I know she won't mind me saying it. But little Summer Minor, she wouldn't speak. She walked with her head down, and she was rocking in school just like I was. But can I tell you now, she owns a business. She has a happy marriage. She has two beautiful daughters. She's a community leader. She's back in college. Why? Because that little girl that life tried to break got into the presence of God and got a word that stirred up something on the inside of her. I'm just hoping somebody gets a word in them that cancels out every lie. Veronica's married and happy because she got a word that turned in her eyes. One word from God changes everything. Somebody give him a hand clap of praise. I'm going to have church all by myself if I have to. Back to old Simon Peter. I was preaching about Simon Peter one time in the youth service. We're trying not to repeat that. Veronica was there. I'll tell y'all after church what happened. It was in Whitewood. But anyhow, everybody saw shaky Simon. But when Jesus looked at him, he said, I see the rock. And Jesus was committed to bringing out the best when everybody else had labeled him by his worst. Ain't that kind of how life is geared up? But the problem was, there were times he would just rise above expectations. And there were times he would plummet greatly. In fact, in the same chapter, Jesus looked at his disciples. He said, who do men say that I am? And some said, well, some say you're Isaiah, you're Jeremiah the prophet. Some say you're John the Baptist. Some even say you're Elijah, come back. Jesus said, that's good. Who do you say that I am? The other 11 remained silent. But Simon Peter said, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. This uneducated fisherman, the teachers had told couldn't get anything, had received something. And Jesus looked at him in amazement and said, blessed art thou, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood have not revealed this unto thee, but my Father. He said, what you just got, you didn't get from flesh, you got from the Spirit. He said, Peter, this is the revelation, and upon this rock, I'm going to build my church. I can see Peter's chest sticking out. I can see his head going up. And a few verses later, Jesus starts telling him he's going to have to be crucified. And the same man that Jesus just said, you spoke by the Spirit of God. A few verses later, Jesus tells him how he's going to have to die. And Peter says, not so, Lord. I'll kill them all. And Jesus looks at him and doesn't call him Peter, doesn't call him rock. He says, get behind me, Satan. How do you go in six verses from being used from God in one sentence to being used of the enemy in the next? Same way you do. Come to church, you feel the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah! I love you, brother. Get stuck at the red light when you're dying to get your Big Mac. Get behind me, Satan. I've seen people, and that's what messes us up, is you don't realize sometimes you can be speaking out of the wrong spirit. One time I told my mom something as her son and not by the Holy Ghost. And mom said, Barry, I'm not doing what you told me to do because I know what God told me to do. And I got mad at mom. But mom had heard God, and mom didn't listen to me. Mom listened to God, and mom was right, and I was wrong. Because mom knew I was speaking out of my love as a son and not by the Spirit of God. What I'm trying to tell you is sometimes good people can say the wrong thing. Sometimes people that love God and will go to heaven when they die can say the wrong thing over your life, over your destiny, over your dream. And Jesus knew how to tell when he was speaking from the spirit and when he was speaking from the flesh. And so y'all know the story. When it all went down, Peter chops the ear off. Peter follows far behind. And Peter sees Jesus die. And Peter gets disappointed. Peter cusses. Denies that he ever knew the Lord. The cock crowed. Jesus died. Peter was crushed. Was disappointed. The only people that get disappointed in life are people that dared to believe God was going to do something great. If you ain't never been disappointed, it's because you ain't never wanted more. You ain't never wanted better. Disappointment does not mean you don't have faith. Disappointment does not mean God is not with you. Disappointment is actually an indication that you believe God for more. It just didn't happen the way you thought it would happen. But God sent me here to tell somebody, delay is not denial. Just because it's been delayed does not mean it has been denied. It's going to happen. It ain't going to end the way you thought it was. Because y'all know the story, so I can't re-preach it. But on the third day when the stone was rolled away, our God got up and he said, I want to find Mary Magdalene. I want to find my mother Mary. He said, I want to find those 10 disciples that didn't deny me. He said, while you're at it, make sure you go get my buddy Peter and tell him I want him back. They gave up on him, but I never did. Can I tell you, others might have given up on you, but Jesus will never give up on you. He knew you in your mother's womb. He knew you were going to fail. He knew you were going to struggle when it called you. But God sent me here to tell you, I got you, and I'm going to bring you through this. Let the saints of God stand to their feet and give Jesus some praise in this place. Don't mind, but you put up Mark 16. Y'all remain standing. Verse 7, just one more time. Because I want y'all to see the power of this. If we would have given up on anybody, if you would say, I don't know Mary Absher, and I've been as good to you as Jesus had Peter, and then you would have cussed, said, Blake, no, I don't know Mary Absher. And then in my darkest hour, I would have looked all around, I couldn't find you. When I come out of my jail, I probably wouldn't be thinking about it. Unless I wanted to just show off and say, ha-ha, I'm not here without you. But that wasn't the heart of Jesus. Jesus said, I know Peter's bawling so bad, but Peter thinks there's no way back. I wonder how many people in here, can you imagine the field day Satan had on his mind? Peter, God was going to use you. He was going to build his church with you. And you cursed. You denied him. You got disappointed and you gave up on him. But here's the word. Go your way. Tell his disciples and Peter. He didn't leave him out the same way he won't leave you out. I want you to lift up your hands right now. Because the whole trick of the enemy is to make you feel like the one God left out. The one God gave up on. The one that messed up too bad for God to hear your prayers anymore. I want you to know God saying, yeah, blessed city on the hill. And Mary. And Carly. And Veronica. And Brad. My God is a God that includes people in the plan. God's not walking around this church saying, who can I kick out of this plan? God's going to run this church to that person that feels the most disenfranchised, the most unworthy. God said, you too, come on, I got a plan for you. You too, I got a plan for you. He said, Pastor, you don't know how bad I blew it. God's saying, you too. He said, Pastor, you don't know what I deal with in my mind. Yeah, and you don't know what I deal with in mine. We all in this thing together. Once you lift up your hands to the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, I want to pray over you, Spirit of the Living God. I thank you that you're a me too God. That you don't hug everybody else and leave me out of the equation. That you go across this place looking for people to love on and be good to. I counseled a young man one time. Taylor, I'll never forget this. I was chaplain at a Christian school. There was a young man that came to me. He left public school and came to the Christian school. And I would have to counsel him every week. And he told me about this teacher that every Wednesday he would hand out candy to every kid in gym class but him. And he would do that to prove to that kid that he was the least in that class. And he would tell him, Joel, he would tell that kid, you ain't never gonna be nothing. And that kid would sit on my couch and cry and tell me how that teacher did him. And my flesh wanted to go line that teacher out. I want to say, buddy, do you realize the damage you did to a vulnerable kid? And I saw the pain that had just been put on him because that teacher made him feel like he was the one that excluded from everything. That's the whole trick of life, to make you feel like you're the one that can't be used, the one that's done too much wrong, the one that don't fit in, the oddball. God just wants us to come in here tonight. He wanted to love on you through his word. I want to pray for you. Spirit of the living God, I thank you that you included Peter in your plan. And God, I thank you that you included me in your plan. And God, I thank you for every mess up we've had, for every struggle we've had, for every tear we've cried. It might have shocked us, but it didn't shock you. My redemption was not an afterthought. Your word declares that he was the lamb slain from the foundation of the world. Before Adam's fall or Moses' law, there was a lamb slain. You always have a way of escape. You always have a new day for us. And right now, by the power of the Holy Ghost, I pray to you, God, and I ask you to break off every word that's trying to limit them. Every word that's trying to break them. God, I ask you to stir up their faith. Stir up their gift. Stir up their ability to dream again. Let them know, God, you've been with them through the whole journey. Not just when they came to the altar, but when they were acting crazy. You were the one that made sure death didn't get them. You were the one that made sure that car wreck didn't happen, that gun didn't go off, the overdose didn't occur, or didn't take them out. That you've been working with them their whole life to get them to a place that you can let them see what it really feels like to be living. God, I think that a new season is erupting. Let's start with the way they see you, the way they see yourself. Now, with every head bowed and every eye closed, I wasn't going to do an altar call, but I'm going to. If you're in here and you need prayer, like I said earlier, you can fake me out. You can look so good on the outside and be so broken on the inside. By the Spirit of God, I feel God just hugging on somebody that feels like Peter fell. You need a touch from God tonight. You feel so alone. I just want you to have a point of contact because I believe something's going to break off of you. I'm not going to ask you to come up here and kneel. I'm going to ask you to come up here and stand, and me and Carlene's going to pray with you. If that's you, would you come to this altar tonight?